Today we're going to talk about hard drives. We're going to take a look at both desktop and laptop hard drives. A hard drive, simply put, is where all of your data is stored. Now this is different from memory. If someone asks how much memory you have, they're talking about RAM, or random access memory, which is a different component that we'll cover in another video. There are several different types of hard drives out there, but the first one we're going to look at is the IDE. This is an IDE drive, which stands for Integrated Drive Electronics. You can see that it has pins for the IDE cable and for the IDE power as well. IDE is older technology, which is reflected in the access speeds. There's also a jumper, which is a little plastic piece that allows for cable select or deciding if it will be a slave or master. For cable select to work, an IDE drive must have its jumper set to CS and be using a cable that supports it. For jumper settings, you can look at the label. And to change the jumper, it's as simple as pulling it off and placing it on the appropriate pins. SATA stands for Serial Advanced Technology Attachment. SATA is a newer technology and is much faster than the older IDE drives. The SATA drive doesn't have pins like the IDE does. There is a SATA power connection and a SATA data connection. There is a spot for a jumper, but you typically won't see that on a SATA drive. The standard size for both types of hard drives is about 6 inches by 4 inches, which, for obvious reasons, will not fit into a laptop. These are made for desktops only. And with a desktop, you're able to put multiple drives within the computer. For multiple hard drives, for both IDE and SATA, you will need a cable for each drive that connects to the motherboard, as well as a power cable for each drive. The power cable comes from the power supply, and the data connects to the board. On a board that has SATA connections, you can put up to 6 drives if you have the space available. And now an even newer technology is a solid-state drive. These are even faster than the SATA drives, but they cost a lot more too. Which leaves the SATA drive as still the most commonly used. And as far as the IDE, you don't find too many of those anymore. Now laptop hard drives are very similar, but there are a few differences besides the obvious contrast in size. For the IDE, notice there is only one strip of pins, and there isn't a power cable. Rather than using cables, the drive will plug directly into the IDE port, which is built into the motherboard, supplying both power and data. And on some laptop drives, there will be a small plastic tab to help pull it out. Taking a look at SATA drives for a laptop, you can see that the connections are the exact same as for the desktop. This makes it universal in the sense that you can mount a laptop drive in a desktop computer, if you have the proper mounting. The label tells us all of the important information about the drive, and some things not all of us really need to know. Some of the important information included is the manufacturer, jumper information, the speed, and the storage capacity, which on this one we can see is 160 gigabytes. Storage capacity is simply the amount of data your drive can hold. Hard drives can have a wide range of sizes, but typically these days they're in the hundreds of gigabytes and sometimes even into the terabytes with external hard drives or mass storage devices. The speed of a hard drive is measured by RPM. This drive here is rated at 7200 RPM. This means that the disk spins around 7,200 times in 1 minute, or 120 times per second, to give you a better idea of how fast that really is. So the faster the disk speed, the faster it is able to access data. For example, if you need to access a document which is stored here, the faster it spins means the faster it will reach the ARM and be read. Listed with the speed is usually a cache. The cache is a small amount of memory in the drive circuitry and is sort of a buffer between the drive and the rest of the computer. Now that we've covered the basics, let's take a closer look inside of one now and check out what parts make up a hard drive. The first component to look at will be the controller card. A lot of times, if a drive is not working, a simple troubleshooting step is to replace the card with an identical one from another good drive if you have one available. Often, this can be a simple fix to a hard drive problem. Here we have a hard drive with the controller card already taken off the back. To open up the hard drive, you will need to remove all of the Torx screws. And there's usually a screw hidden under the label as well. Now that we are inside, this is the control arm, which reads the drive by scanning back and forth. This is somewhat similar to how a record player works, except it reads from the inside out. Things such as your operating system and other programs that come installed on the computer will be closer to the center, and then it will work its way out. Things added later, such as documents or other programs, will be stored further out on the disk. The disk is also known as a platter, and are typically made of non-magnetic material and have an extremely thin coating of a magnetic material on top. Now, we won't get into details in this video, but the platter is separated into tracks and sectors. Tracks are concentric circles and sectors are wedge-shaped. This helps with the organization and filing of the data. Data is stored in these magnetic fields in a digital format as ones and zeros. Now before we finish, here's just a quick example of how this works. If you wanted to watch a video file on your computer, you would click your mouse on the file, a signal is then processed through the controller card, and within milliseconds, it tells the arm where that file is located on your hard drive. Once located, the data is sent back through the arm, which leads to the controller card, and back through the system board to be displayed.